I'm live! Sorry, I was frozen there for a second. Hello, hello, hello. We're here again. Says it's building my audience. Building. Sorry, I was a little bit late. 1 minute late. I know. Shame, shame. I'm usually very punctual. I hate being late. Even 1 minute. Michael!
Woo!
Tracy! Awesome. I was late because I was getting coffee. Yes, it's true. I am Wonder Woman. Thank you, Jeff, for letting me know you hear me. That's always good to do. Greg! Exclamation point, exclamation point, exclamation point. Leonard! You're going to make all the obvious jokes. Ooh, there's an in-joke there. So tonight, we are going to read from one of my very, very favorite books. So excited, Off to Be the Wizard, by the inimitable Scott Meyer. This guy can write, and he can write comedy. He's actually does stand-up comedy. I think that's partly why he's so funny. But when I read his stuff, it's one of those things where I have to stop because I'm laughing a lot, because he is so, so good. What's on today's agenda, Josh? Well, we're going to be doing a little reading. Coffee is the only drink to have, that's right. I put a little cream in it, a little sugar, and a little cinnamon on top just to make it fall-like. Mmm. Oh, I've got the power of Wonder Woman filling me. Good evening, Risa. Crap, I'm late! Michael, it's okay. I was late, too. What happened to the beard? I don't know. It fell off. I made that joke last week, so I got nothing. I shaved it. Do you know how sometimes, like, you get frustrated and you just need a change? Well, that's what happened. I was frustrated. Plus, I notice when the beard gets long, all I do is start doing this. And it becomes like this tick, and I don't like it, so I had to change it. Snuggle Pumpkin! Snuggle Pumpkin! Is that Irish? Is what Irish? Oh, no, it's not. I wish. Ah, cinnamon on coffee. That's right, Iris Jean. Hello, Crystal. Maybe we'll do it every Thursday. I've got a couple of them planned. We'll make some announcements in a little bit, so there are some good things in the works. Thank you, Ryder. My voice is very good. I appreciate that. The power of Wonder Woman compels you. That is the best part of that movie, by the way. The kids love that movie. All right, let me pull up my script here. I am wizardly. Yes, tonight is all about wizards! There will be magic. I don't know. I don't know what it's going to be, but there will be magic. Hi, Spencer, and hi, Mackenzie. Hello back to you. Oh, you listened to Purloin Poodle on the way back from the World Series game. Go Cubbies! I lived in Cleveland for a while, but I'm definitely rooting for Cubbies, but maybe they can all win. Can it be a tie? You know, they're all great. Greetings from Copenhagen, Denmark, Nadia. Very wonderful. And from Norway, Otto. Very good. A little earlier next time. 2:05 in Europe. I'm sorry. Bodan. Is it Bodan? That's a great name. I wish we could make the time zones all converge. That would truly be magic. Yeah, Scott Meyer, I see the link for Wikipedia. Check him out. He's got a great bunch of works. And he is just one of my favorite writers. He just makes me happy inside. I need the beard to be wizardly, but the wizardly comes from within. You're right. You don't have the magic book at the library. We're going to have to look into getting your library the magic book. Hello from South Australia. It's the mid-morning there. It always blows my mind, Zoe, that it could be tomorrow. So I'm actually telecasting into the future. There's your first bit of magic. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And Jenna's already on Hammered. She loves your voice. Thank you, Jenna. Thank you. Rather than listening to an audiobook while washing dishes tonight, you're going to watch this. Good job, Sarah. Hey, someone from Ypsilanti, Michigan, a fellow Mittener. Good job, Jerry. We love Michigan. And hello, Sulis. All right, so I've got up my stuff. You like this look better than the full beard? It's good that I can do both. I can change it up. So what I thought is, I went through the script for Off to Be the Wizard, and there's so much that I want to share. There's so much. So what I did is I picked three different sections, And I'm pretty sure I don't want to, like, give away anything, but I don't think it's going to be giving away too much if you haven't. Hello from Canada. Very, very good. Off to the audiobook. Got your four-year-old hooked on books. That's great. What's up, dude? You missed the beardage? It's coming back in. It'll be there. It doesn't take long. It grows fast. Hello, Robert. So, turn off Simon Vance. You need a Simon Vance impression. Hello, I'm Simon Vance. I am a very accomplished narrator, and I have a very soothing and wonderful voice. And I do lots of classics, like Dickens. I just like to say Dickens. What the Dickens? With the delay of the internet, you're also transmitting into the past. Jeff, that's our second piece of magic. Love it! Laura Wickham, your boyfriend, loves me. I love him too. He has good taste. Both your kids are hooked on Iron Druid. Get them listening. That's good. Good evening, Robert. Yes, the listening is a great way to introduce kids to literature. I think that it makes them excited. And the fact that people listen, I think, is really important. I made a post about this last week, but listening is a lost art. So get them to listen. Everyone needs to listen. It makes us better, more empathetic people. Sherlock is watching. Donnie, I got your poster in the mail today. Yeah. Hopefully you guys should get it in a week or so, or a little less. I don't know. Time traveling. Well, time traveling is what this book is about. Segway. So this book, Off to Be the Wizard, is part of the Magic 2.0 series written by Scott Meyer. And our main character is Martin Banks. Martin Banks is, you're considering naming Dog Oberon, that would be good. You used to listen to LPs. Wouldn't it be cool if audiobooks were on record? I think somebody did that. Amy Poehler's book. I saw her have a post and she had a record of it. That's pretty cool. You're the man, Charles. Martin! Brad! Hello, sir. I'll be seeing you in a couple weeks. I'm very excited about that. Miss you guys. Martin Banks is a hilarious protagonist. He kind of is one of these guys that you love, and he just keeps making mistakes, but he's so good-hearted, and he's very intelligent, and he gets caught up in this whirlwind of events. So let me just give you a little bit of backstory here before we jump into the first section. Martin Banks is really good with computers. He's kind of a loner. This is in modern-day times, and one night, while doing some internetting, he discovers a program, a computer program, and using this program, he can change things. It kind of starts to look Matrix-y in that life is a program, and so by changing the code in the program, he can make himself taller, or he can make himself shorter, or he figures out how to teleport, or he figures out how to fly, but he's not very good at it, so when he flies, it just kind of, like, shakes him, and he's like, So, 50 people? Woo! We got a party started. Cheers, everybody. Floogy. There's going to be a lot of in-jokes tonight. I apologize if you haven't listened to the series because there's a lot of things that are just like catchphrases and stuff. And that's always annoying when you don't know them and you're like, well, I don't think it's funny. Floogy, what's that? It's just, you're going to have to listen to the whole thing. Sip break. Joey, the first to ask about the new Off to Be the Wizard. I talked to Scott today, all right? I sent him a message. I said, we're doing this. He knew about it. And I said, everyone's going to want to know. And he told me that he is working away in his dungeon, and it is there is no release date yet. So I don't have that to give away. But I can tell you that it is in process, and he's very happy with it. So if he's happy with it, I'm happy with it, because that man is amazing. Vicky, you should check it out. It's great. So Martin has discovered this computer program, and he started to use it for illicit means, meaning he starts to figure out how he can type into his bank account and make deposits in his bank account and make himself have money. Well, it's not long before the FBI gets wind of this, and they come and arrest him. So our first scene takes place between two special agents, Miller and Murphy, and they have him in an interrogation room, and they're going to interrogate him about how this money came to be in his account. All right? So Let me don the magical headphones. Instantly transported. Let me turn on my microphone. Check, check. There it is. Check, check, check. And I have the computer program set up, so we're going to record this on Pro Tools. Excuse me, burp. Nice, Jason. Nice. Hey, Bethany, I got your poster off today, too. Woo! All right. I sent posters off for our last event. I did some signed posters in a giveaway with some trivia. And this time, if you stay tuned, there's going to be some trivia, and I'm going to give away download codes so you can get a free book, perhaps Off to Be the Wizard. But there'll be some questions, and people that type in the first response, they'll get a download code later on. I apologize. One of the things I noticed last time, sometimes because of the internet's wonkiness, someone might have answered before someone else, and then I saw one that answered and I claimed them as the winner. I'm really sorry if that happens. If that happens to you, then write me a direct message and say, I actually answered first, but this other chachi got the prize. So I'll try to rectify that. But I'll try to pay attention too, but it's hard because I've got screen, and keyboard, mouse, microphone, and all of you. So it gets a little overwhelming. Sip break. All right, the first response. Say hi to Becca. Hi, Becca A. Love you, girly. Oh, was I supposed to say that? You just downloaded it while starting, Mindy. Man, thumbs up. That was magic, too. So much magic. I don't know why I did that. That was horrible. I'm sorry. All right. So we're in the interrogation room with Martin Banks, our protagonist, who has discovered this program that he doesn't want to tell anybody about, and the two special agents who've discovered that he's somehow getting these deposits into his bank account, but they don't know how, okay? All right. So we all may see our own response first, Jeff. Yeah, you're a smart boy. Wonder Woman, yes? She's awesome. I love her. He's the best. The movie looks so good. Oh my God, it's going to be so good. All right, shall we start one? Now we have three different sections. So this first one I'm going to do, and then we'll talk a little bit and maybe give away a download code, and then I'll do another one. Sound good? Is my hair okay? There. All right. Your day has now become epic. I'm kind of doing this sing-song thing because I'm doing a book and the character literally is described as having a sing-song voice. Oh my God. And so it's hilarious and really fun to do, but now it's leaking into everything. Anyways, silence from Greg. Word, Jason. Okay, Ed, here we go. So let's start this, everybody. Ready? What book? We're doing Off to Be the Wizard by Scott Meyer. Special Agents Miller and Murphy came in and sat across the table from Martin. Miller was tall and muscular, with a receding hairline. Murphy was average height and doughy, with unruly brown hair. They both looked happy. Miller silently read papers in a manila folder, with Martin's name written theatrically on the tab. Eventually, Miller closed the folder and put it on the table.
"Mr. Martin Banks," he said. "We're going to ask you a few questions. The more quickly and more honestly you answer, the sooner we can all go home."
Martin considered this. "So, I may be going home tonight?"
"Oh, definitely, Martin. You're going good."
Oops, first mistake. Always got to get that out of the way, and then things go better. Hey, Dave.
Catch up, Greg Fraser.
All right. "So, I may be going home tonight?"
"Oh, definitely, Martin. You're going to go home tonight. But bear in mind, jail might be your new home."
"Ah," Martin said. Miller continued.
"See, my partner Murph and I aren't from Seattle. Heck, until today, Murph had never been to Seattle. Isn't that right, Murph?"
"That's right."
"See, we had to fly up from L.A. on no notice because of you. That's where we live, L.A. Hey, Murph. Why do you live in L.A.?
"Because I hate rain."
"He hates rain, Martin. So you can imagine how happy he was to have to come to Seattle in October. You happy, Murph?
Nah, I ain't happy.
He's not happy, Martin. You got anything to say about that?
Martin stammered. If he were any more off balance, he'd be lying on his side. I'm sorry?
Murph doesn't want your apology, Martin. He wants answers. If you answer Murph's questions well enough, we can go home tomorrow. And maybe get some sightseeing in before the flight. Would you like that, Murph?
Yeah, I'd like that.
Murph wants to go sightseeing, Martin. Maybe see the Space Needle, or that market you got where you throw great big fish around for no reason. Murph's seen it on the Food Network about 1,000 times.
Oh, Martin said, mostly out of reflex.
If you do go to the fish market, right next to it, there's a little shop that sells the best tiny donuts. You don't want to miss out on that.
There was a silence so thick you could lean on it.
Why?
Special Agent Miller asked, almost too quietly to hear.
Because we're cops?
No! Martin said, an edge of desperation in his voice. They're just great donuts. A little machine makes them fresh, and they give them to you in a brown paper bag.
Shut up about the donuts! Murph doesn't want your donuts. Murph wants you to answer his questions.
Then when's he going to ask a question?
Shut up, Martin. I'm asking the questions here.
That's kind of my point.
Shut up! Shut up! Shut up!
Miller sat down and panted for a while. Murphy just stared at Martin. Finally, Special Agent Miller continued.
Look, kid, we're Treasury agents. Until recently, we used to investigate bank fraud. And we were good at it.
Too good, Murph said.
That's right, Murph, too good. We were so good we got promoted to a special task force. A small task force. Elite, they call it. How many agents are on our task force again, Murph?
Two.
Two agents. Me and my partner, Murph. I'd say that's pretty freaking elite. We investigate the bank fraud cases where nobody can figure out what the fraud was, even the bank that got defrauded. That means that before we can start solving a crime, we gotta figure out if there was a crime at all. That's why we're here, Martin. To try to figure out if you've committed a crime.
They sat in silence for a moment.
Have you committed a crime, Martin?
Another silent moment passed. No?
Good! Glad to hear it, Miller said. Perhaps you can tell us how you managed to put 5 separate sums of money, totaling more than $23,000, in your bank account without making a deposit or a transfer.
Martin had never stopped to add up all of the cash he'd created.
Wow! That's a lot of money.
Not really.
Special Agent... Ooh, yeah, I'm right. Sorry, I thought that was a different character. How we doing out there? So ready for the 4th, me too. No timeline yet on delivery, but he's writing it, Jeremy. Wow, that's a lot of money.
Not really,
Special Agent Miller said.
Normally, it takes more than $100,000 to get our attention. It was the number of times money just showed up that made the bank suspicious.
This news did not make Martin happier.
I'm screwed, he thought. The jig is up, all the way up. Even if I get out of this, they'll be watching me for the rest of my life. My best-case scenario is that I get to go back to my life the way it was. Only now I'm unemployed and gave all of my furniture to Goodwill. Well, at least I can buy it back for cheap. It won't come to that, though. They'll pin something on me. I'm going to prison. I can't see how I can get out of this.
So, you gonna tell us, Martin?
Martin had been so absorbed in his misery, he'd nearly forgotten the men in the room with him.
Pardon?
He asked, startled. Special Agent Miller smiled.
My partner, Murph, and I were wondering if you'd tell us how you got all that money into your account without depositing, transferring, or even earning it, as near as we can tell.
Martin perked up instantly.
Oh! I'll do better than tell you. I'll show you. All I need is for you to bring me my smartphone.
Agent Murphy stood up and with a bright smile said,
Will do. I'll be right back.
That's the first section. Woo!
So, obviously, Martin has access to this file that can make him teleport and do stuff on his smartphone. So, if they're going to give him his smartphone, then he's going to be able to get out of the shenanigans. That's just a little scene to kind of set up his humor, the dialogue and stuff back and forth. I'll tell you my favorite line. You want to know what my favorite line? Of just this scene, there's so many. Where is it? Oh, it was after the donuts. There was a silence so thick you could lean on it. That's so good. That's so good. It just forms this tangible feeling. Oh my God. It is a really awesome book. Jason, what's up got to be? It doesn't allow this stuff. Oh, it doesn't. Yeah. You're craving donuts now? Me too. It would be perfect with my Wonder Woman coffee. Man.
My dear friends and Philip.
He's coming.
Can you do a Morgan Freeman voice?
If I could, I'd be a millionaire. That guy's amazing. I could just wrap myself up in his voice and take a nap. This is where... Is this where I recorded this book? No, I recorded this book at a professional studio called Brilliance Audio.
Brilliance Audio presents...
You've heard that before, I'm sure. You got coffee too, Brian? Oh, it's such a good series, Laureen. You should totally check it out. All right, how about we give away a download code? Boop, 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 boop. All right, warm and fluffy Freeman voice.
It is.
All right, our first question. So what you do is write in an answer if you know. I'm going to start with an easy one. And I have to say, I went to my brother. I have two older brothers who are awesome. And I went to my oldest brother, James, who is a writer, lawyer, and Arthurian scholar. And this book takes place in medieval England in King Arthur's court. So I went to him and said, what are some good questions I can ask? And he wrote up a bunch of lists of them. But I also have to say, here's another little, brain just totally gave out of me. Announcement. That was the word. That's a tough one. No donuts, just beef Thai curry. Get it, Vanessa. James! Another fantastic narrator you should all check out is James Foster. Type that into your little notes. James Foster. He is top-notch. Really great, great, great. Really great narrator. Your brother is Jimmy?
No, my brother's not Jimmy. There's another character in this book named Jimmy, and he is fantastic. But my brother doesn't talk like this. That'd be kind of weird.
Okay, Tidbit. Yeah, that would be a good one. What's up, James? Tidbit. So my older brother James, who's the writer, lawyer, and Arthurian scholar, came up with these questions for our giveaway, but he also has written several books, and I'm happy to announce that I'm going to be doing the audiobook for his first one. And his first one is an awesome historical romance called The Viking's Bride. And it's so good. It's so good. He's just great. And I'm super excited to work with him and that he's going to let me do it. He and his wife, Osni, which is her birthday today. Happy, happy birthday to you. It's her birthday today. So everybody say, happy birthday, Osni. And she and him wrote the book together, and there's also a sequel to it, and I'm going to produce the audio version of it, and I'm really excited, so stay tuned for more information on that. Okay, first question for a download code. Everybody ready? Which King Arthur's knight did battle with the Green Knight? Which King Arthur's knight did battle with the Green Knight? Oh, look at all those happy birthdays for Osni. Good job. Romance. That's my jam, Crystal. It's good romance, too.
Lots of Scottish accent.
It's Osni is A-A-S-N-E. It's an awesome Norwegian name, and she's an awesome person. Yeah, A-A-S-N-E. 250 comments so far. Lancelot? Nope. Good guess, April. Good guess. Yes, Leonard, you got it. Download code coming your way, my friend. Leonard, make sure you message me and remind me that you won, and then I will send you the download code, all right? We'll do it all afterwards. It was Gawain and the Green Knight. Gawain? I've never known how to pronounce that. It's like Neil Gaiman. It's pronounced Gaiman, but for a long time I was like Gaiman. Look at all these people. John, Randy, Joey, Jeremy, Laureen. Yep, good job, you guys. You got it right. But Leonard beat you to the punch. Good job, Leonard. You'll get a download code. All right, let's read another one here. Another little section. A little tidbit. I'm a snake. Have you guys seen that video? I'm a snake. It's so funny. Sir Robin ran away. 'Tis but a flesh wound. All right, so we are going to introduce a new character now. No one knows how to pronounce Gaiman until you hear someone else say it. It's right, I had to look it up. Gaiman. It is Gaiman. That guy's awesome. He's magical. There's our third magic of the night, Neil Gaiman. Woo-hoo. All right, so in this scene, Martin has now traveled back. What mic is that? Rode NT1A, James. It's actually my older brother, James. It's his old mic. He used to be an audiobook narrator as well. That's kind of how I got into the business. And he bequeathed it to me. American Gods. I can't wait for the TV show. Oh, my gods. Oh, my American gods. So good. So, this scene, we're going to introduce a new character. His name is Philip. Philip. Philip is one of my all-time favorite characters. And Philip, so Martin ends up in, yeah, there's going to be a TV show on Showtime, I think. He has, to evade the police, he has gone back in time to medieval England. And yes, Philip! And he is trying to pass himself off as a wizard. Because he can do these things with the program and the phone to appear like a wizard, like changing stuff. And so he thinks that if I'm a wizard, I'll be safer in this really scary time period. Are the voices color-coded so you know when to change voices? No, Scott, but I did used to do that. So for 3 years when I first started, I would diligently go through and color-code everything. And this was on paper, so I would go through highlighters like crazy, and I would highlight all the different characters. I've been doing it long enough now that I can read ahead as I read and know what's coming up, so I don't have to do it anymore. But if you're starting out, you really, really have to do that kind of work to get to that place. So anyways, we are in our first scene where Martin has been taken under the wing of Philip, who is another wizard in medieval England, all right? So how does he keep his phone charged? That becomes an issue. You'll have to read the book because I'm not going to give away too much, but that does become an issue. So they have other ways of dealing with things. All right, so are we ready for a little bit? Sore. Every part of Martin Banks was sore, including his mood. It felt good to stretch out, though. He opened his eyes just a bit. He saw a wall made up of broad, flat stones mortared together. There was a narrow window made of a very crude glass letting in sunlight, staining it a sickly brownish yeller color. Sorry. It's powered by magic and coffee. Peter! There's another great narrator you guys can check out, Peter Burkrot. This guy has been around since like the 1800s. Cheers, Peter. He's really good, though. You should check him out. Because everybody gets tired of listening to me every once in a while. All right. Where was I? There was a narrow window made of a very crude glass, letting in sunlight, staining it a sickly brownish-yellow color in the process. Martin inhaled. His ribs hurt. There was an aroma in the air. He didn't know what it was. He just knew that he wanted to smell more of it, preferably while eating whatever was making it.
It wasn't bacon, eggs, and coffee. It wasn't toast. It didn't smell breakfasty at all. It smelled beefy, with some onion and other vegetables thrown in. He smiled and thought, "It smells like stew."
Martin sat bolt upright, instantly enraged. Philip was sitting at the foot of the bed in his blue robe. In his hands, there was a large steaming bowl.
"Stew?" he asked.
"Oh, that's Philip. I screwed up my first Philip line." Peter reads everything. Someone asked what Peter reads. He reads everything. He's really good. "Where'd I get the Wonder Woman mug? I stole it from my wife."
Philip was sitting at the foot of the bed in his blue robe. In his hands, there was a large steaming bowl.
"Stew?"
he asked, pushing the bowl forward invitingly.
"You! How?
I'm going to spell that for you. He spells it G-D-A-A-A-A-A-R-G-H. So as a narrator, you come on that and you're like, those are the best to do. I love it when authors put in sound effects and words like that. So,
"You! How could you?"
Martin sputtered with rage.
"How did you do that? How did I get here? How long have I been unconscious? What did you do to me? Give me that stew."
Philip laughed and gave him the stew. Martin ate greedily and angrily. He was lying on top of the bedding, fully clothed, but his shoes were removed. Philip walked over to the corner, where a cooking pot hung over a small fire. It was a medium-sized room with stone walls, simple furnishings, and exposed rafters. It was a room imbued with the kind of simplicity that the rich could afford, and the poor saved up to get rid of. Homey though it was, the dirt floor and the open fire reminded Martin...
Burp.
I'm always taking in so much air. Scott does that just to confound me? Yeah, he does.
Homey though it was, the dirt floor and the open fire reminded Martin exactly where and when he was. Philip picked up a jug and poured some of its contents into a rough clay mug.
"Good morning, Martin. I'll answer your questions, but not in order. You've slept about 9 hours. Gwen, the young lady who brought you into town, and I went out into the woods to find you as soon as we could after the duel. We found you unconscious, floating about 3 feet above the ground. You were just lying there, vibrating. It looked like you'd bounced off of a few trees before you came to a stop."
Philip put down the jug and walked toward Martin.
"We gathered up all of your belongings. I put everything in a pile over there by the wall. Everything but this."
He held up Martin's phone. Martin stopped eating.
"Don't worry, I haven't tampered with it. I know better than to mess with things I don't understand. I pushed the glowing square that said hover, thinking it'd bring you back to the ground. It did. Much more violently than I expected."
Philip was now standing right next to the bed. Martin watched him warily.
"Now, your most important question. What have I done to you? The answer, Martin, is that I tried to talk you out of making a fool of yourself. And watched you do it anyway. Then I traipsed through the woods in the dark, gathered your belongings, and snuck you back into town. I gave you a safe place to sleep, and watched over you in case your injuries were more severe than they looked. And now I've given you a nice bowl of stew. My point is, if I had any intention of hurting you, I'd have done so while you were asleep. Or simply left you alone to hurt yourself. I didn't. That should prove my goodwill. Agreed?"
Martin nodded and started shoveling the stew into his mouth again.
Good!
Philip offered the clay drinking cup.
Have some of this to wash your stew down.
What is it?
Beer.
Martin took the cup.
That's lesson one, Martin. Don't drink the water unless you've boiled it to within an inch of its life. If you want to stay healthy, stick to wine and beer. The alcohol kills the bacteria.
What do you mean, lesson one?
Martin asked with his mouth full. I always love it when they do that, too. Make me talk with my mouth full. I've gotten really good at it without anything in my... am I covering my face too much? I'll move over a little. Here, let's do this. That'll help.
What do you mean, lesson one?
Martin asked with his mouth full.
Well,
Philip said, returning to his seat at the foot of the bed.
That brings us to your last unanswered question. How did I do that?
Martin stopped eating.
Don't stop eating. You're clearly famished. Try some of the beer.
Martin took a large mouthful of beer. Philip asked,
Did Pink Floyd ever get back together?
Martin ejected a large amount of beer through his nostrils. Philip made no attempt to hide his enjoyment.
My name is Philip McCall. I was born in London in 1948. My family immigrated to America in the 70s. I graduated from MIT. In 1983, I was snooping around AT&T's mainframe, and I found a copy of the same file I suspect you found.
Martin put down the empty stew bowl. He kept the beer.
So, I'm not the first person to find the file?
No.
How many copies of the file are there? Has anyone else found it?
Many people. We can't know for sure how many. As for the file, there's only one file. What we find aren't copies, just... I guess you could call them projections. Ghost images of the one true file that show through into our reality. I think it's some kind of glitch. Anyway, we've proven that changes made to the file on one server instantly affects all other instances of the file in real time.
Well, the fact that you found the file, too, clearly explains how you did what you did last night.
Yes. Sorry, I didn't want it to come to that, but you forced my hand.
No, I get that. I'm sorry.
Martin shrugged. I feel like an idiot.
No,
Philip said.
You're not an idiot. You just thought I was.
The whole past to escape to, and I pick a time and place that's already taken? What are the odds?
Pretty good, actually. I assume you read the Cox book?
What?
Martin asked.
The Cox book. The Best Years to Live in Medieval England, by Gilbert Cox.
Martin dimly recalled the Amazon page describing the book that he had decided to trust after reading its title and the first sentence of its description.
Oh, yeah, that book! Yeah, that is what made me pick this year, he said.
Philip's face lit up.
Good, isn't it? Rarely makes history come alive. It's not perfect, of course, but it's amazing how much he got right.
I haven't read it, Martin said.
Pardon?
I haven't read it, Martin repeated.
If you haven't read the book, I suppose you must have seen the BBC documentary series he made. They ran it in America on PBS.
No, didn't see it.
None of it? There were 4 episodes.
Martin shook his head. No, sorry.
Did you read one of his follow-up books?
No, I read the title and a synopsis.
A synopsis?
Martin shrugged. Part of the synopsis.
Ah, yes,
Philip said.
You're an American.
Was it my accent that gave me away? Martin asked.
Partly. The Cox book is what led the rest of us here as well. Once we got settled, we went in and set up a script that buys a number of copies every year to keep it in print. We want to lure as many people who discover the file here as possible. All the copies are delivered to a warehouse in Cornwall. I'm sure we've made Mr. Cox's descendants quite rich. You should really read the book, Martin. It makes a good case for this time. Relative stability, good crop yields, the Crusades keeping the violence far away. Good stuff.
Philip could see that he was losing Martin.
More stew?
He asked. Please. You said we set up. How many others are here? No. How many others are here? Philip took the empty bowl over to the stew pot.
20-some. It's hard to say. People drop in and out, go back to their own time, check out other periods in history. That's just the people we've identified, mind you. The ones we met because they chose to come back to medieval England and be a wizard.
It never occurred to me to go anywhere else.
Me either. I think that's because we're both white males of European descent. We're in occasional contact with a group of sorcerers living in 8th century Baghdad. And, of course, Atlantis.
Atlantis is real?
Oh, yeah. Most of the women who find the file end up going there to live. What can I say? Ladies like a man with a swimmer's build.
They sat in silence for a moment while Martin dug into his second helping of stew.
You were hungry, weren't you?
Philip asked.
Okay, my turn to ask a few questions. Where and when are you from, Martin?
Seattle, 2012. And no, Pink Floyd doesn't ever really get back together. Three of them put out some pretty good albums with Roger Waters, but it's not the same. They did a one-off performance for charity, but then the pianist died, and that was pretty much that.
Shame. How long have you been in this time?
Less than a day.
You got into an impressive amount of trouble in that time. How long ago did you find the file?
Martin thought for a moment, then answered. A week ago?
And I get the impression, from your general lack of preparedness, that you fled here. It seems you have a talent for getting into trouble. That pocket-sized computer of yours, are they common in your time?
Yeah, almost everyone has one.
The future must be great. I accessed the file on a Commodore 64 and an acoustic coupler.
You should go to the future and check it out.
You know I can't. You must have tried to go to the future. We all try it. We can't go there because it hasn't happened yet.
Martin furrowed his brow. Well, I can't, because that's really the future, but your future is the past. Well, I can't, because that's really the future, but your future is the past. At least part of it is.
From your point of view. Get used to hearing that phrase, Martin, and get used to hating it. From your point of view, I'm a walking time capsule from the primitive yesteryear of 1984. But from my point of view, anything beyond the day I left my time and came here has not happened.
Excuse me. But I'm here, and I'm from your future.
No, I'm from your past. We're both here in our past, so whatever infernal program uses the file can access this time from its memory and put us here together. But in the 80s, when it processed my life, you, your pocket computer, your clothes, none of it exists.
Maybe I could take you to the future with me.
Maybe you could, but you won't. You're not the first person from my future to turn up, you know. And they all start out saying, sure, Philip, I'll take you to the future. But then later it's all, I don't know, Philip, what if one of us ceases to exist? And how can I argue with that?
That's got to be frustrating.
Frustrating doesn't do it justice. All I get are dribs and drabs of information that come up in conversation, most of which I don't understand. Near as I can tell, all of popular culture and most of the English language gets taken over sometime in the early 90s by something called The Simpsons. I know this because nobody from that time or later seems to be able to put a sentence together without quoting them, and everybody giggles like idiots, and if I ask them to explain, all anybody ever does is laugh and ask me a condescending question about Bananarama.
Martin tried to not smile. Philip took a calming breath, then continued his questions.
So, what kind of trouble did you get into? Did you get caught manipulating your bank balance?
Yes. How did you know?
Lots of us get pinched that way.
Did you?
No, I actually managed to keep things together for a year before I was found out. I had a good-paying job I enjoyed, so once I proved that I could change my balance, I didn't have to.
How did you get found?
Well, I had a lot of time to play with the file before I had to flee. I found a little chunk of code that you could append to any variable in the file to make it a constant.
That's how you could fly so smoothly.
Exactly.
All right, that was a long one.
Woo!
You guys still there? Goodness graciousness. I don't want to give away too much, and I already read a bunch, and it's late. It's like, what time is it? We've already almost done an hour, folks.
That's crazy.
Hi, Jennifer. All right, sip break, everybody. I want to do one more, and then we're going to give away the rest of the download codes, and then we'll call it a night. But this next one's really, really good. I want to do it. All right. Okay, here we go. The Jimmy statue. I don't want to give that away. That's too much of a big ending part. April. April asked if I could read a specific part, but I don't want to give it away. That was fast, says Greg. Good. Oh. How do you decide which books to narrate? I usually get offered, and then I decide if it looks like something I like. All right, everybody. So, the White Council of Wizards. You're getting better. All right, so let's see here. Sip. Oh, they do a cool thing with this book on Kindle where you can get it and it's like illustrated and the illustrations move. Hey, Mud, how you doing?
Merlin.
All right, a wicked Dr. Seuss for the kids. I could, yeah. All right, so let's do this last one. This is kind of towards the end and it's an action scene, okay? But I'm not going to give too much of it away, all right? The name of the book, Josh, is Off to Be the Wizard. Do I edit them yourself? Yeah, I do edit them, but then I send them off to somebody who cleans it and processes it and makes it all pretty. I haven't seen the new cover for Frontlines, Iris. Is it cool? Kindle in Motion. Thanks, Boden. That's what it's called. You're still up? Good job. Fox and Socks. Yeah, it looks really good. Okay, so let's read this last little bit here. Oh, my God. All right. Martin felt his imp box with his smartphone inside rattling around in his robe pocket and beating against his left hip as he ran. It was maddening. His robe, his hat, his staff, his phone, all of them had been so powerful just 10 minutes ago, but now they were as useless as if the shell had never existed. Hang on, Martin thought. My phone could do stuff before Philip told me about the shell. That's how I got here. He risked turning around and running backwards for a moment. Hey, Phil, he yelled. He said he disabled the shell, right? Philip was badly winded and losing speed. He spoke between huge gulps of air.
Yeah, so what?
He didn't say he disabled the file, just the shell.
Yeah, it's really,
hard to cut someone off from the file. We can do it, but it takes a lot of doing. You can't rush it.
Martin didn't say anything. He just dug out the silver imp box and showed it to Philip. Philip looked puzzled for a moment, then started screaming,
"Do it! Do it now! Do it!"
Martin flipped the lid of the box open. The smartphone screen glowed invitingly. He pulled up the app and looked at the options. He could go back to his own time and be arrested like a civilized person. No thanks. He could teleport himself away and watch from a distance as his friends got beaten to death. Not much better. That left one option. He pressed the hover button and immediately bobbed 2 feet into the air. He heard a ragged cheer come up from the other wizards, but he was more concerned with the bone-jarring vibration he'd never bothered to fix. Also, with his feet no longer touching the ground, he was quickly losing speed. Philip must have noticed this too, because he grabbed Martin's sleeve and started pulling him through the air behind him.
"Okay,"
Martin said, sounding like a goat sitting on a paint shaker.
"I proved it works! I'm gonna stop now!"
Philip yelled,
"Don't you dare! I've got an idea!"
He maneuvered Martin's vibrating body so that he was skimming along 2 feet above the ground, head first and face down like Superman. Martin was wondering what Philip had in mind when he felt Philip jump into the air and land with his knee in the middle of Martin's back. Martin let out a pained yell as Philip started kicking the ground, propelling them forward, riding Martin like a scooter. Martin started to complain, but Philip cut him off, saying,
"Pipe down! You owe me one! Okay, who else has a pocket computer that can access the repository file?"
Philip yelled. A disappointingly small number of voices answered. Martin couldn't be sure, but he thought he heard three. Gwen and Jeff were two of them.
"Right,"
Philip said.
"We need a diversion. Ideas?"
An endless moment passed. Then Jeff said,
"You know what? I think I got something. I gotta stop running to do this. Keep going, no matter what happens to me."
Gary yelled, "Done." All who knew him realized that this was what passed for an expression of concern from him. That's it. I just wanted to do the vibrating thing. You'll lose a filling. Yeah, I was shaking. Sometimes I do this too.
Okay, who else has a little pocket?
Because the shaking, you have to be careful because it can come through on the mic. Oh, man, that took a lot of energy. Sip break. Sip break.
The ladies.
All right, guys, let's do another giveaway. So Leonard11, we've got a couple more questions here. Let's see. All right, for a free download code, answer me this. Do I ever hurt yourself from actions during narrating? No, not often, but I have to be careful, that's true. All right, are we ready? Here's the giveaway. Are we listening? What mystic healer advised Russian Tsar Alexander II and survived multiple assassination attempts? What mystic healer advised Russian Tsar Alexander II and survived multiple assassination attempts? Looking for a name here. Rasputin Mud, you got it. All right, good job. So make sure you direct message me just by a hair, Crispin. I'm sorry. And Jason, you guys all got it right, though. And Vanessa, close. But Mud, make sure you message me, and then I'll make sure to send you the download code. All right, good work. We've got more to give away, though, so let's do another one. What French apothecary... Let's do it French. What French apothecary wrote a book of predictions in 1555, which many believe have relevance even today? I'm going to read that as normal, because you might not have gotten it. What French apothecary wrote a book of predictions in 1555, which many believe have relevance even today?
No time to Google.
Nostradamus! Crispin! There you go, you got it! Right in front of Brian, I'm sorry, dude. And Michael. Crispin, make sure you send me that message so I remember, because I'm not writing these down, okay? Good job, good job. All right, let's do another one. James, my brother, came up with some good ones. Love you, man. You're the best. I have two fantastic brothers. I'm very lucky. And they're both really talented. All right. Here's a good one. Roman invaders were scared of Britain's druids because they believed the druids could make it rain what? Roman invaders were scared of Britain's druids because they believed the druids could make it rain what?
Make it rain!
Not fire, April. Good guess, though. Mud has already messaged me with wanting his, you're fast. Not frogs. What could druid? Blood! Brian! Boo! You got it!
Ow, that was really loud.
Good job, Brian. Send me that message. Rain dollars. Make it rain. All right. Cats. That would be horrible. I would much rather have it rain blood than cats. Make sure, who was it that did it? Brian? Send me that, okay? Yeah, Brian Elliott. Toads. They believe they can make it rain blood.
Kidney stones? Oh my god. Snakes.
Okay. In ancient Rome and Athens, who was the patron goddess of witches, wizards, and magic? Josh thinks he got it first. All right. Yeah, I hear you, Josh. If you want to send me one, I'll give you one, too. I didn't see it, but I could have missed it easily because I'm up and down. Hemorrhoid cream. Jason, clean it up. This is a tough one. In ancient Rome and Athens, who, not Athena, Ed, good guess. Yes, Jeremy. Dang. Is it Hecate or Hecate? Hold on. My brother wrote me what it is. I have to look it up. Hold on. I asked him, is it Hecate? In ancient Greece, they would have said Hecate. But nowadays, it's either Hecate or Hecate. Either way. God, he's smart. James, you're awesome. So the first Hecate I saw was from... Who said that? I'm looking back through there.
Don't.
Jeremy Snyder. You're the first one, so send me your direct message, okay? Internet is laggy. Yeah, if it's doing that, I always post this afterwards so you can watch it without all the lags and stuff like that, so check it out if the internet's acting wonky. Good job, guys. You guys are smart.
It's because you read books. It makes you smart in the brain.
All right, so I think we have... I got a hard one. Who was the official court astrologer and magician for Queen Elizabeth I in Shakespeare's day? All right? Who was the official court astrologer and magician of Queen Elizabeth I who was in Shakespeare's day? I'm looking for the name of the magician for Queen Elizabeth I. That's a tough one. Someone is messing with the file. That's why it's lagging. Darn it, Martin! Smart in the brain. You got a hard one. Leonard, I can always rely on you to go there.
Philip, that's a close guess, Ed, but not.
John D. Barbara, good job. That's amazing. It says, John D. Through his medium, Edward Kelly, he summoned angels and spirits and kept a journal of what they told him. Close, Dave, but Barbara got it first, okay? So Barbara, send me that message, Doctor Who. He was posing as John D. Good job, Atticus. All right, I got one more. Uno más, okay? Sarah Palin? Yeah. Nice job, Barbara. Okay. Legend has it that King Arthur was taken to this island to hopefully recover from his wounds after being injured fighting against his great rival Mordred at the Battle of Camlann. Okay, so what island was King Arthur taken to when he was wounded to try to recover from his wounds? The island of Avalon! Crispin, you got two. Crispin. I'm tempted to not give you another one, Crispin. I'm sorry. I know. We'll see. Let's give one to Jason, too, because he was the next one. Jason Matthews. All right, I saw the Avalon from you, too. Jason Matthews, make sure you send me a note so I can remember to give you a download code. And Crispin, you're almost too smart for your own good. And you've got an awesome name. All right, so those were the ones. And I think we're right at 9 o'clock, 9:01, so we did an hour. So we're going to wind it up. I do want to say there's my one that I always do. This isn't a question, but if any of you have special needs children, or maybe you're nurses that take care of special needs children, you can direct message me as well, and I'd like to give you a download code, because that's my kind of jam. I think you people deserve much more than download codes, but I really want to help out that in any way I can. So if you are somebody that does that and works with people like that, make sure that you send me a message and I'll get you a download code too for being so awesome. Hey, Carla, are you done with your private jet? Carla put a message out earlier saying, I won't make it. I'm going to be on my private jet. I was like, oh, awesome. Can I be on your private jet? His Google foo is strong. It's okay if people look it up. It's still listening and you're still learning. Oh, Marco Cluse just posted the next cover for Frontlines. I will check it out. Thanks, Iris. Frontlines is another series, space sci-fi I do that's really good by Marco Cluse. Good night, April. Everybody here, thank you for tuning in. Last thing I'll say before I let you go is I'm going to do another one coming up for a new series by a fantastic writer named Terry Schott on a book, a series of books called The Game is Life. And it's really, really good. It's 3 a.m., Nadja. It's time to go to bed. That's going to be one coming up. And I also have approval from Mr. Scott Meyer to do one of these for his book called The Authorities, which is a hilarious separate series from this series. So next week, Thursday, this time, we'll just keep the Scott Meyer party going and do one for The Authorities. So everybody, thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you so much for watching and taking part and for listening. Hey, Sarah, I sent your poster today. Good night, good luck, and keep listening. I love you guys. Oh, I got to do a cool face for it to end because usually it freezes on that face.